write a book, they said. It'll be easy, they said. The money will roll in, they said. It's not how it works, right? But there is a way in which you can conquer your fears about writing books. You'd be surprised what some of the top fears are. Conquer those fears about writing a book and turn it into something which really generates you a massive business. That's what we talk about today with my guest, Mitali.
You're listening to the Keith Blakemore-Noble Radio Show, helping you transform your deepest fears into your greatest strengths. Here's your host, Keith Blakemore-Noble.
Hey, hello, welcome to another episode. Now, my guest this week is a ghostwriter turned international best-selling author and business book expert. Her name is Mitali Deypurkaystha, otherwise known as the Authority Creator. Now, Mitali transforms coaches, consultants, and speakers, turns them into thought leaders by enabling them to become published authors within 90 days. Pretty fast. We're going to explore some of that in the course of this discussion. Now, featured on ABC, NBC, CBS, and Fox, she's helped her clients generate over $5 million in additional business revenue. That's pretty impressive by anyone's standards. As a recipient of coaching and mentoring for weight loss issues, addiction, mental health, business, and career, she has made it her life's mission to help coaches, consultants, and speakers to succeed. Her favorite business book, Start With Why by Simon Sinek. That's my guest, Mitali. Hey, Mitali, how are you doing?
I'm doing very well. Thank you for having me, Keith.
My absolute pleasure. It's great to have you here. So, normally I would say, okay, we've heard your bio, but who is Mitali? But you know what? We're going to take our cue from your favorite business book. Start with why. Why do you do what you do?
Gosh, well, I think in the intro that kind of explained a little bit about it. I wouldn't be where I am if it weren't for coaches, consultants, speakers, mentors, therapists, counselors. Oh my God, I've seen them all, Keith. I really have. I still have them now in my life. I have a therapist and I have I have a business coach and a business mentor. So there's three people in my life right now helping me, and I think I'm reasonably well adjusted human being now. I was a bit of a mess in my early 20s, unfortunately. I managed to go down a really dark path where I became addicted to amphetamines. I lost my home. So I ended up in a homeless shelter for just over a year. And again, it was these amazing coaches and therapists and consultants and people who came into my life who really gave me the motivation and got me clean and got me my life back. So the reason why, to answer your question, is I owe these people my life, my business, my fitness, my everything. I think a lot of people don't talk so much about that. There's this whole thing about family's a big thing. You know, when anyone says, you know, oh, that person's really into their family, it's seen as a positive. I'm not saying it shouldn't be seen as a positive. It is wonderful if you have a lovely family who are supportive. It is wonderful if you have lovely friends who support you. But no one seems to talk about the fact that actually the people who you're probably the most honest with, brutally honest with, is they're not your friends and family usually. With friends and family, you love them so much, you want to protect them from the ugliness that is you, you know? And we all have ugliness inside of us, let's be honest. So I certainly found that whenever there was anything going wrong in my life, the people I turned to were coaches and mentors and consultants, not friends and family. I'm not saying I don't have a wonderful, you know, support network of friends and family. I do, but I want to almost protect them from things that are going wrong in my life. I don't want to burden them, you know? But you don't mind burdening your coaches and mentors and consultants, because that's what they're paid to do. You know, that is what you're paying them to do, to take on your troubles and help you with it. So, and this is why now it is my life's mission to help these people. I found out around the beginning of the pandemic last mm-hmm. year, I found a couple of statistics that I found really upsetting. So one was the International Coaching Federation that stated 82% of coaches fail within 2 years. And then the Bureau of Labor Statistics stated that 80% of consultants fail within 2 years. This is, by the way, pre-pandemic stats.
Yeah, yeah.
So Lord only knows what that stats, what those stats are now. I don't even want to know, because I find it really upsetting. So I've been ghostwriting and copywriting for over 6 years now, and I'm working with all kinds of entrepreneurs, coaches and consultants too, but also all kinds of entrepreneurs. But last year, I decided to focus specifically on helping coaches, consultants, mentors, speakers, instead of being so, I guess, more general. You know, I just kind of worked with entrepreneurs, which, let's face it, there's so many things come under the umbrella of entrepreneur. So I decided to focus more on these people because I had an affinity with these people, because it helped me so much in my life. And also, from being somebody who wrote pretty much all things, you know, I could write anything. So if you wanted to hire me to write a leaflet, an email sequence, a book, a sales page, you could hire me. I knew how to write all these things. I decided to focus specifically on book writing, because looking back over the last 6 years, when I started to study the impact that my content had had on my previous clients, the piece of content that's made the biggest difference to their business has been the book. There's something about becoming a published author that people really respect. You know, no one really, if you have a website, no one goes, well done, you've got a website. Now it's more like, why wouldn't you have a website? If you're a business owner, you have to have a website. Same with, you know, a business card. No one pats you on the back for having a business card. It's like, well, yeah, of course you have a business card. We all do. Whereas something about becoming a published author, people really respect, you know, and the authority that they get from being a published author just starts attracting the right kind of people to their business in terms of clients, but also collaborators. And yeah, my previous book clients, they've been able to, you know, build six-figure businesses. A couple of them have built seven-figure businesses, and they can trace it back to the book. I'm not saying, you know, they just published the book and suddenly, hey, millionaire, you know, there is no push button solution. Of course.
You mean you don't just publish a book, sit back and let the millions roll in?
Wouldn't that be amazing? Oh. I would love that. Yes. I'm still amazed the number of people. Yeah. I'm still amazed, Keith, that the number of people who think they can just stick a book on Amazon and suddenly the world will stop turning on its axis or something. Yeah. And it's like, I'm sorry to tell you guys, that's not how it works. You know, I'm not sure it ever worked that way, but it certainly doesn't work that way now. I was told a few weeks ago that on average, 3,000 plus books a day are uploaded on Amazon around the world.
Wow.
Per day.
That's so if you think,
even if you've written it's crazy. I mean, I don't know if that statistic is true, but that's what I was told by somebody who is in that business. So I think he was telling me the truth. But yeah, that just gives you an idea of the scope here. So even if you've written the best book since, I don't know, the Bible, it's going to get lost in a sea of noise there. So you can't just upload something and that's it. It's all about getting out there and leveraging the book. But that's what my previous clients did do. I gave them a book. They didn't just go, brilliant, I've got a book. They went out and they leveraged the book to death. You know, they used it to prize open doors for speaking engagements and podcasts like this. And they really leveraged it to have this amazingly increased visibility. And that's what's then built their business.
Got it. So, I mean, books, I've heard somebody described a book as basically just like a really big, high quality and very impressive business card. In that it's not, as you say, it's not the sales of the book. You don't publish the book, sit back and the royalties roll in, but it's what the book lets you do that's the important thing. So it's like, instead of, as you say, everyone's got a business card, but when you send somebody a book, say, hey, I hear you want to talk about X, Y, and Z. I've written a book on the subject. Let's talk. Is the truth to that, or were they just kind of trying to big it up?
Well, I mean, I would turn that question back on you, Keith. If I sent you, say you told me you're interested in writing a book.
Yeah.
I mean, you're already an author, so you already know what you do. But say, let's go back in time and you haven't written a book and you think, I really want to write a book, but I just don't know how to go. I don't know how to go about it. Now, you can go into Google and you can type in book coach, and there's a ton of us. You know, and we're all saying the same thing. We're flipping wonderful. Of course we are. It's our website. We're going to say we're wonderful, aren't we?
True.
But then one of them actually say, I reach out to you and say, hey, let me just send you a copy of my book. It's called The Freedom Master Plan. And it's 7 case studies on my previous book clients and how they've used their book to build 6 and in some cases, 7-figure businesses. Would you be interested in working with me if I did that? Compared to all the others who might send you a letter or send you their business card and you're thinking, great, wonderful, I'm getting no more value.
Yeah, it certainly grabs the attention, absolutely grabs the attention. And
that's exactly
what it establishes your credentials as well. Yeah,
exactly. I've already done that with my book. I've sent it out to potential students and most of them have come back and said, I want to work with you.
Brilliant. So we get that books are really important things to have, and we get that when leveraged correctly, they can represent a massive return on investment. So let's kind of explore. I mean, I guess for a lot of people, that the thought of, okay, I get that books are really good, but oh my God, I've got to write the book and publish. Oh, for a lot of people, that can be quite a daunting task, maybe even a scary task. I mean, I guess for a lot of people, it brings back awful flashbacks to being at school and having to write essays and all this sort of thing. What have you, I mean, you've worked with a lot of people. What have you found are sort of the biggest fears that hold people back from actually writing their books? And how can they kind of start to overcome some of those?
Well, I would say the biggest fear is when you write a book, you really are putting your head above the parapet. You really are. Now, as an entrepreneur, we've already done that a little bit. So, you know, setting up, I always find entrepreneurs just amazing people anyway, because they're already different from the norm. In that most people will never own their own business. You know, they like the idea of, you know, they might complain about their job, because that's just, especially in the UK, it's a national obsession. You need to complain about your job, even if you actually secretly like it. You're not allowed to tell people that. No one relates to you if you say, oh my God, my boss is amazing. You know, my job is amazing. Everyone's like, I don't really want to hang around you. You're not fun. So you kind of have to make up the fact that you've got a terrible job and a terrible boss. So people who have already made that leap, they're already quite extraordinary. Their brains are already, wired in a different way, I would say, to the norm. Mm-hmm. So they've already put their head above the parapet. But that is, writing a book really is next level. It's one thing setting up a business, having a website with your face on it and business cards and sales pages and emails and all the rest of it. A book really, I mean, it really sets you up as, this is almost like your manifesto. This is what you stand for. Actually, that just reminded me, how rude of me, Keith. I didn't actually answer your very first question. We went off on a tangent, didn't we? You were talking about why my favorite book is Start With Why. But I will answer that now for you. I apologize, Keith. I do that. I go off on tangents. Yeah. So, but this ties in with this question. In your book, I really believe, is your most complete form of your message, and it really allows you to tell the world why do you do what you do. A business card can't do that. It's too small. So a business card may say, great web designer, but why do you design websites? You know, I can say, hey, I'm a great book coach, but why do you teach people to write books? Why are you a book publisher? And people are already doing that in a smaller capacity on social media and blog posts. If you think about it, you're kind of doing that when it comes to marketing. You let people into your world. That's just how marketing works in 2021. So you're already doing that on a smaller capacity. But when you do it in a book, it's a really grand way that you're doing that. And that, I think, is a big fear for people because it's next level visibility. And some entrepreneurs, they're just kind of like, I want to make more money, but can I do it without being more visible? And it's like, that doesn't work in 2021. You know, You want to make more money, you need to become more visible. And the way to become more visible is writing a book, absolutely, and talking about why you do what you do, because people are interested in that. Yeah. The one thing I find is unless you're in some sort of cutting edge industry where you are literally the first person to do something, in that case, no one really cares about your story because they're just so amazed about your new thing that you're doing. For example, you know, these new vaccines that are turned up to fight COVID. No one's going, well, I'd like to know the story of AstraZeneca. No one cares. It's just like, is it safe? All we care about is this safe? Is it not going to give me blood clots? And will I not get COVID? That's all we care. Yeah. We don't want the story behind AstraZeneca or Moderna or Pfizer or anything like that because it's cutting edge. But the vast majority of us are in an industry where there's so many other people doing exactly the same thing. I have so many other book coaches and book publishers to compete with. I'm sure you do as well. You know, in your industry, there's tons of people doing it. So then you have to differentiate yourself from the other people. And I would say the absolute best way to do that is to tell people your why, tell people your story so they resonate with it. They see the human being behind the brand, behind the business. And then they go, oh, I just like that person. The way I say it is if you don't differentiate yourself on your why, you will be differentiated on something that you don't want to be differentiated on, and that's price. And that's the worst thing to be differentiated on because now you're getting into price wars and you're having to keep on top of your competitors and keep pricing yourself lower than what your competitors are doing. And then they start doing that and you just basically go both going down this hole now where you're just undercutting each other.
Yeah.
That's never going to be a good thing for you. So that's why it's my favorite book. Simon Sinek's Start With Why. He talks about the importance of why and how to go about creating your story, your why. So that's why it's one of my favorite books. And I would say should be mandatory reading for all coaches, consultants, speakers, all entrepreneurs, I would say. It should be mandatory reading.
Okay. So
sorry that I answered that two questions later.
That's all right. No, don't worry. It's all good. You've answered it. That's the main thing. So getting back to books. So we've got the entrepreneur who's going, right, okay, yeah, I know having a book is going to elevate me to the next level. It's going to make me stand out. I know I need to share my why in the book because that will help attract people to me, help people going, this is the person I need. But it's still a scary prospect writing the book and doing all this stuff. And what kind of fears come up for them? And I guess more importantly, how can they go about starting to overcome those fears enough to be able to embark upon the journey of book writing?
That's a great question, Keith. So I would say there's two main fears. First would be imposter syndrome. Mm-hmm. There's nothing like the concept of becoming a published author that makes people think, oh, I'm not good enough. So then they start creating all of these excuses. So it's like, I need to be in business for two more years longer then I feel like I'd be good enough to write a book. Or I need to get just this one more qualification, then I'd be good enough to write a book. And I'm just thinking, where is the law saying that you need this qualification or that? Look, I'm not saying if you know nothing about a subject, go and write a book. Please don't do that. You'll be found out and people will laugh at you, quite rightly so. But the way I see it is, if you've got a viable business, you're making money, you're making a living from it, and you have clients or customers who keep coming back to you and needing your products, services, whatever it is, that's enough authority for you to write a book. I mean, one of my sayings is, why wait for authority when you can create authority for yourself? Authority isn't something that will come to you, sadly. Every so often someone will say, oh, I was given this award and then I realized I was really good. But most of the times you have to create the authority yourself. You've got to decide you're good enough to step up to the plate and say, I'm good enough to be an authority. So that's one way of overcoming it. I always say another great thing is, if you're feeling imposter syndrome, go and speak to a few of your clients who are happy. A lot of people don't do that. They don't get the testimonials, you know? One thing I do is I get video testimonials from my students, because I think it's the most human. I can really see their face, hear their voice tones, everything. And they always say the most amazing things about me. Now, first of all, of course, they're going to say amazing things because I've asked them for a testimonial. But every single time they go above and beyond what I expect them to say. I expect them to say, oh, she was great to work with. She really helped me get across some mental blocks, et cetera, et cetera. But they usually go beyond that, and they're usually like, oh, she really helped me out. I was really stuck. I've been wanting to write this book for years. I never thought I'd be able to get out of my head. They say these amazing things that go far beyond what I was expecting from them. And that really helped me come out of my imposter syndrome. Because you might be surprised to find out, Keith, that I suffered from huge imposter syndrome with my latest book. And a lot of people find that difficult, because they say, well, you're a ghostwriter. So you've written 7 of these damn things already. Why did you get imposter syndrome with the 8th one? But the reason why is, as a ghostwriter, you write the book and you hand it to somebody else.
And it's
so I was safe.
Yeah.
As long as my client liked the book enough to pay me, then that was my job done. That was my cue to accept the money via PayPal and then go find a really nice beach to go and sip some cocktails on. I didn't have to deal with anything else. And now I was writing this book with my name and face on it, and everyone's going to know it's me, you know? And so I had to, and one of the ways I got over myself is I started to get video testimonials of people that I've worked with, and they were just saying these amazing things about me. Mm-hmm. And that made me realize, damn it, I am good enough to be an author. Why shouldn't I be an author in my own right instead of a ghostwriter?
Got it.
So that, what I would say, is one fear. The other fear is fear of the grammar police. That's a big one. People get people get really, they suddenly revert back to being, you know, at school, where they maybe had a horrible English teacher who told them that, you know, you're terrible, and, you know, they would get back essays with red pen everywhere. That worries them. You know, people, I think, are okay with writing a social media post or blog post because they know, you know, they will be forgiven for any typos or any grammar mistakes. But the bar is set a lot higher in books, as it should be. The bar is a lot higher in books, and that is what they're afraid of. And to that, I would say, you know, just take my advice as, you know, a bit of a veteran when it comes to writing books, in that I would much rather, in fact, I do, on a weekly basis, I will take on students who have a great idea, who are, their grammar sucks like you wouldn't believe, but I will take that person on rather than take on a person who is grammatically perfect but their idea sucks, you know?
Yeah.
The thing is, the way I always say is, grammar, punctuation, spelling, that is not even your job as a writer. That is the editor's job. So why are you beating yourself up about something that's not even your job? It's a bit like beating yourself up about cleaning the home when you have a cleaner. Like, if you don't have a cleaner, then you should beat yourself up about the fact that you've got a dirty home. But if you've got a cleaner, you don't beat yourself up about having a dirty home. You go and speak to your cleaner and say, hey, I'm going to sack you unless you come in and clean my home. Well, in the same way, when you're writing a book, the grammar, the punctuation, all of that is the editor's job. It's not even your job.
Right.
So why are you beating yourself up about it? Don't even think about that English teacher who was making you feel bad about the fact that your grammar was terrible. That's not your job as an author to be looking at things like that. That is a job of a great editor.
Got it. Okay. Now that's interesting. That is really interesting. I wouldn't have guessed that that was a massive fear that holds so many back. And as you say, it's so easy to overcome. Because you just realize, okay, maybe I'm not brilliant at grammar, but hey, I have an editor.
That's not your job.
Their job is to do that.
My
job is to get the ideas.
Exactly. Have the ideas. That's it. I've even had students who are so worried that they want to go over their work one final time before it gets to one of my editors. I'm like, what are you doing? Why are you wasting? Yeah. That's the job of my. I pay my editors really well, by the way. They're some of the best paid editors. So I'm like, I pay my editors a ton of money to do this. It's almost like people who wash their hair before they go to the hairdressers. Like, it's going to get washed.
Oh, yeah.
So why are you washing your hair? I don't. I turn up with a greasy mess and going, but I'm paying you for this. But I know people who wash their hair before they go to the hairdressers. And I'm going, that wouldn't make sense if you're just having a dry cut. But if you're having a wash and blow and cut and everything, which most women do especially, why are you washing your hair? And that's what my students were doing. They were, they wanted to go, let me just check it one more time just to make sure there's no typos before it goes to the editor. Well, my editor's going to do that. So to get that thing out of your head. Your job as an author is to get the best knowledge, expertise, inspiration into your book. The rest of the stuff, you know, dotting the I's and crossing the T's, editor does that.
Brilliant. That makes a lot of sense. Now we're coming to the end. I know you've mentioned your own book as opposed to the many ones that you've ghost written. Just in a nutshell, a couple of sentences. What is it that your book is about? And I guess why would somebody want to read it? What are they going to get from it?
Well, I wrote the Freedom Mastermind because I was sick of people asking me, is it worth writing a book? And I just wanted to scream every single time. It's like, oh my God, the question should surely now be, why would you not write a book? You know? So I wanted to create a book that definitively said, absolutely, whatever kind of business you're in, how could you not benefit from being seen as an authority? How could you not benefit from being seen as the expert above your competition? How would that not be a good thing ever on this planet, wherever you live? You know, so what the Freedom Master Plan does is it follows the journeys of seven of my clients. And it shows you what they did next with their book. So they got the book, you know, from me. What did they do next? Because I think that's really important. It's one thing me saying, hey, writing a book is a fantastic thing for your business. But as an entrepreneur, I know, being one myself, our time is short and we have to make decisions on where we best spend our time and do the things that will make us give us the biggest return on investment. Otherwise, we're going to go under. It's as simple as that. So a lot of people have this idea of writing a business book or a how-to book, but they just can't see exactly, but how does this fit in with my business? Like, what would I do with a book in my specific business and my specific environment that will take my business to the next level? So with my book, The Freedom Mastermind, you read that, and you'll get somewhere in the region of nearly 30 different strategies and tactics that my clients have used to leverage the book. Are they all going to fit your situation? Absolutely not. But what you can do is by the end of it, you would have a game plan in your head. You'd be like, yeah, I can definitely do this and this and this and this with my book. And if you've already written a book, great. If you're one of these people who are duped into thinking that you can just stick a book on Amazon and the world will stop turning and nothing happened, and you're now feeling disillusioned that you spent all this time writing a book and it didn't do anything for your business. If you read the Freedom Master Plan, you can cherry pick the strategies that will work for your business. Go and leverage your book now and get it to start working hard for you. And if you haven't written a book yet, hopefully it will inspire you to write a book, because you can now see the end game. You know, you can see exactly what you're going to do with your book once you have it, once it's published.
Got it. And that's all in the Freedom Master Plan. Nice.
That is. Yes.
Brilliant. Well, Mitali, time always goes far too quickly in these. Thank you so much for taking the time to be with us. You shared some great stuff here. I know a lot of people are going to want to find out more, get in touch with you, get the book. What's the best way? The best way for people to find out more or get in touch?
The best way is just go to my website. So it's quite simple. It's thefreedommasterplan.com. So thefreedommasterplan.com. If you go there, you can even download a sample chapter for free, see if you like it. And if you do want to go and get it, you go straight over to Amazon and you can download it on Kindle, or you can get on paperback if you're old-fashioned like me and you like proper books, whatever you prefer.
Awesome. So that's thefreedommasterplan.com.
Correct.
Check it out there. As Mitali says, you can even get a free sample chapter. What more could you want? Because Mitali is also on all the socials. We've got all of her links, including links directly to where you can buy it on Amazon. And so we've got all of that in the show notes for this episode in the usual place, keithblakemorenoble.com/show, and look for The One with Mitali. You'll find all the details there, where you can get the book, the whole lot. Again, connect with her at thefreedommasterplan.com. Mitali, thank you so much for taking the time to be here.
Thank you for having me, Keith. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure. And thank you, dear listener, dear viewer, however you're catching this. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you've enjoyed it, please do remember, give us a like, a subscribe, a comment, share it with your friends. Let others know about this and other episodes. I will catch you same time, same place next week. Now I'm just going to leave you with my guest's favorite quote. It's from Dame Maggie Smith. Speak your mind, even if your voice shakes.
Been listening to the Keith Blakemore Noble Radio Show, helping you transform your deepest fears into your greatest strengths. To find out more, please visit keithblakemorenoble.com.